Announcements. Next month on Thursday, August 12th, we'll have Professor Levon Chukaluzian will be speaking at the Glendale Public Library. He's sponsored by us as well as the Organization of Istanbul Armenians and NAASR. And if you don't know him personally, he's a great guy and he's always got something really, really interesting to say. So that's Thursday, August 12th at 7 p.m. You have a flyer on your seat. And I'll introduce the speaker, and then we'll have a special presentation, and then some questions and answers. And so hold your questions till we come to that part of the evening, and then we have refreshments and we have a room. We're very privileged today to have Dr. Martin Deranian, who is from Worcester, Massachusetts. He's a practicing dentist at the age of 87, which I think is really impressive. He went to Clark University, got his dentistry license and education at the University of Pennsylvania in 1947, the year after I was born. He's been in dental practice in Boston from 47 to 51, at which time after that he joined the Navy and served in the Korean War as a lieutenant junior grade. He has a faculty appointment at Tufts University since 1949. He's very active as a dentist and also in humanitarian things. He was elected a fellowship of the American College of Dentists in 1964. He got awarded as Big Brother of the Year in 67. He has a fellowship named after him for Big Brother, Big Sister. He's published three books, which are back there and available for sale today. The Village of Housenake, Worcester in America, and Miracle Man on the Western Front. The two first books are for $25, the last one is for $40. And you're welcome to scan through them, and if you purchase, that'd be great. So without further ado, Dr. Martin.
Good afternoon, and thank you for your very gracious introduction of me. It's a very moving experience for me to come into this museum with its memory of our life, of our heritage, something that I can never forget. I had the very good fortune to meet Luther Exigen a number of years ago, and I never, never forgot his passion. This program would not have come to life had it not been for the careful attention of Maggie, and I wish to commend her for that, and my good wishes to her. Now, the story of Dr. Varaztad Kazanjian was so compelling and to me and with such dignity that I could not possibly refrain from recording it. My book is the distillation of 20 years of effort, And my quest for the Kazanjian legend led me far afield to London, to Vienna, and to Kazakhstan. Now, I wish, and this is my first presentation, which simply introduces my topic. Now, but I wish to begin my presentation with a very singular event in Dr. Kazanjian's life in 1919. Now, after World War I in 1919, Honorary Major Varaztad Kazanjian of the British Royal Army Medical Corps stood before King George V in Buckingham Palace for investiture as a companion of the most distinguished order of St. Michael and St. George. It's one of the highest honors that can be given to a person who is not a British subject. He was a dentist of extraordinary skill, and he was being honored for his services to the British Expeditionary Forces in France. His treatment of facial and jaw wounds had gained for him the name as the Miracle Man of the Western Front. And in the following years, he was to build a legendary career as one of the foremost practitioners and teachers of plastic and reconstructive surgery in the world, and indeed a father of that specialty. Now, his origins were far different than Buckingham Palace. It was in Turkish Armenia as the Ottoman Empire was crumbling. The date of his birth was March 18, 1879, and the place was the city of Erzincan, in the heartland of ancient historical Armenia, where his family had lived for four centuries, and they belonged to the upper middle class. He came from a long line of coppersmiths, or Kazanjis, and the Armenians had lived in relative harmony with the Turks for centuries, but that changed during Varaztad's boyhood, and it was a time of great peril for the Armenians. But within, and you can show the next slide, please. And within 3 years after his birth, the family moved, this should be Erzincan, to Sepastia. And there he attended a Protestant missionary school and learned physics, chemistry, but never English. And this plagued him the rest of his life. But when he was 12, the family moved to Samsun, which was on the Black Sea. Now, at the age of 15, he became very politically active with an Armenian Revolutionary Party called the Hanchagyan, and he as a freedom fighter, and he was being actually sought out by the Turkish authorities, quote, for passing forbidden political pamphlets in the dead of night, and indeed to save his life, he was literally smuggled out of Turkey. When I left Armenia, he said, it was not because things were bad, but for political reasons. And they joined a group of fleeing Armenians, and they were exploited on their ship. 60 of them had to sleep in virtual steerage. It was a very small ship, he said, and I was very, very sick. And the ship of the name was Cecilia. It was a matter of the Hamburg American Line. A very famous plastic surgeon by the name of Joseph Murray, a laureate, said, perhaps because of his troubled childhood fleeing from the Turks, Kazanjian developed a special sense of caring, and indeed he did. He did develop that. When he was 16, he arrived at Ellis Island in November of 1895, and with a bundle on his back, and that was about it. He was going to be sent back to Turkey, but provincially he was allowed to stay. He had only a few coins, no English, no references. But while he was waiting in Ellis Island, news came of the massacres of 1895, and he was free of that. Now, he was sent directly to Worcester, Massachusetts. Now, that's located about 40 miles west of Boston. That's where I was born. Somehow, like a magnet, Worcester drew Armenians to her, including Kazanjian, and it became the mother community of the Armenians in America. Now, there's actually a dialogue been recorded between, about the turn of the century, between, at Ellis Island, between an Armenian immigrant and an official. And the official says to the Armenian, what is your destination? The Armenian says, America. The official says, you are now in America. The Armenian would say, no, Worcester is America. They just wouldn't believe they were in America until they reached this town. Now, this story has intrigued me, that how come this relatively small city became the home of the Armenians even before Fresno, and that's my other book that is available. Well, the largest employer of Armenians in Worcester was the Washburn and Moen Manufacturing Corporation, the largest wire mill in the world, and there were actually 265 Armenians that were working there in 1889, very early. And Varaztad worked in this wire mill as a wire drawer until 1903. It was very brutal work. There were stories of people losing hands and losing actually their lives in this. And I also must tell you that both my grandfathers worked in this mill, and the trouble is they went back to Kazanjian, and they did not survive 1915. Now let me just show you something about the. Can we have the next one, please? And here is this Washburn Moen Manufacturing Company that I've been telling you about. And the next one, please. And here are these bales of wire. Now this is the time when the West was being fenced off and they needed barbed wire. It's a time when women were wearing hoop skirts. Telephone electric wire was being used, so it became the largest wire mill in the world. And this is where Varaztad worked. And the next one, please. And here is a group of the workers. I cannot identify Kazanjian among them, but this is the foreman with a tie and a hat, and here are the other workers, the way that they look. Now, the early Armenians, they could not walk the streets alone at night. They were called goddamn Armenians, and they were called Turks. But they never became public charges. And he only planned on staying long enough so they'd go back to Armenia. He wanted to go back and fight. This was his intention as late as 1900. He still, years later, and I got to know him pretty well, remembered with trepidation those early years of ignorance of the language, helplessness, hardships, nostalgia for their homeland. Well, his passion for knowledge was so intense that he would actually take a book with him when he worked in this mill. And he said, for 7 years, I did not miss a single night at night school. He even took books with him. But something happened. He was greatly influenced by an Armenian Protestant minister whose name was Hachador Beneyan, who urged him to renounce the idea of returning to Armenia and to stay to America. And he listened to him. He said later, I determined to understand the American psychology, and he even joined a bicycle club. But he was still 21 and still in night school. Now, these workers, the Armenians would always get together, and they would get together usually on Sundays. And on this one Sunday afternoon, they were talking about their careers, and someone said to Kazanjian, you take dentistry, that's a good profession. Well, somehow the idea stuck in his mind. He became a citizen, going back to Armenia, moved to Boston, and enrolled in the freshman class of the English high school. Now, he's an adult. I was a man then, he said, and at first I was embarrassed when I saw the children who were my classmates, but I soon said, what of it? The main thing is to improve my English, he said. Well, after 1 year there, in 1922, he approached, of all things, the dean of the Harvard Dental School and about matriculating. Now, he hadn't come in touch with others and his fellow countrymen up to them, but he was involved that he had to pass an examination. He didn't even have to graduate from high school at that time. Well, he passed the examination, and he was admitted conditionally. Well, but during the term of 1902, he still went back to the wire mill, and again, but he nonetheless matriculated at Harvard Dental School in 1902. And may I have the next one, please? And here's the way he looked when he entered this class of 1902, virtual miracle. Well, one of his classmates, in describing this, would said, well, when the Harvard class
dental class of 1905 first met, it would have taken wiser men than me to pick out the man who a quarter of a century later would have deservedly outstripped his classmates. In fact, I doubt Kazanjian would have been selected among the first 10, handicapped as he was by unfamiliarity with the language and considered to be a foreigner. Well, nonetheless, he did. And when he was in dental school, he became very interested in jaw deformities. And his classmates would laugh at him and say, well, there's no money there. Why are you interested in that? But for him, it was a challenge. I always enjoyed problem cases, he said. But in June of 1905, he did actually graduate with a degree of doctor of dental medicine. And this impossible dream had come true. And he started to teach. And now, if you had a fractured jaw in those days, you wouldn't go to a hospital, you would go to the clinic. And he treated about 400 cases of these fractured jaws, and he would use wire, the same wire that he learned at the wire mill to join these fragments of the jaws together. Well, but he also met a very beautiful, lovely woman, and her name was Sophie Augusta Quindet. She was a Swiss, and they were married in 1912 in Boston. And he got a teaching appointment at Harvard at that time. Now, the largest conflict the world had ever known erupted in 1914 and quickly embroiled Europe. Now, Sir William Osler, the next one please, who was the most favorite physician, educator, doctor in virtually the world, he suggested that Harvard and other universities supply physicians and nurses to staff much-needed base hospitals to take care of the casualties of the British Expeditionary Forces. Now, there was an alarming need for this aid, because in the single month of May of 1915, the number of sick and wounded troops returning to England from the Western Front was 42,000. Horrible, horrible wounds happened at that time. Well, this Harvard unit was rapidly assembled in June of 1915, and there was provision for 32 physicians and surgeons, 75 nurses, and 3 dentists. And Varaztad Kazanjian was the chief of that particular specialty. And here, may I have the next one, please? And here is this first Harvard unit, and here is Varaztad Kazanjian, right, standing there. All right, now the British, the unit sailed out of New York Harbor in June of 1915. Now the war lasted 4 horrible and difficult years, and the opposing armies were trapped below ground in muddy trenches along a virtually stationary line from Switzerland to the North Sea, and in horrible battles that ebbed and flowed, a generation of the flower of Europe's men were lost. Now, remember, it was fought in trenches and close combat, and it produced horrible facial wounds. If you stuck your head above that trench, you were liable to have this horrible facial. And they really didn't know how to treat these cases. They really didn't know what to do with them. Now, this unit was stationed in a French village of Cameres on the English Channel, where they took over a British hospital. And it was under tents. It was a soggy field. But the arrival of this unit relieved the British to take care of their own wounded. However, they remained under the administrator of the British Army Medical Corps. Now, within about a week after he arrived, he called on his superior, a Colonel Carr, and he said, what is being done for the case of fractured jaws, Kazanjian said to him. They were being returned to England, where even there, not very much special training was done. It was bound to happen. One of the surgical cases had admitted 2 cases with gaping facial wounds and fractured jaws, and the surgeons immediately called Kazanjian. He took the transition from dentistry to surgery in his stride so easily that the details of treatment were organized so smoothly and quietly as other cases were being admitted. And the surgeons really marveled at his ability to handle these unusual cases. And this is this is how the first British facial treatment center in France was established by Lieutenant and later Major Kazanjian. Well, he really literally was, his feet were in the mud, and he was doing miracles. And here, may I have the next one, please? Here he is in the office in the uniform of a British officer. And notice, this is mud. They're in tents. And there he is with two other officers. And the next one, please. And almost immediately, newspapers began glowing reports of Americans who went to France with the Harvard unit retained by the British authorities. They performed wonders beyond anything that had been ever seen by them. And here he is pictured. Now, he's just arrived over there, and he does such unusual things beyond any expectation. That is how one of the newspapers described him. Now, he was only supposed to stay for 3 months when the rest of the unit went back to America, but the British insisted that he stay, and they gave him anything that he wanted. They even allowed him to bring his wife, which was unheard of at that time in the war. And may I have the next one, please? And eventually they gave him a whole ward, all of his own. They transferred him to another hospital, and his colonel said, give that man anything he wants. It was said that if Kazanjian stays, countless men can be saved from mutilation and even death. So here he is now in this clinic with facilities at his disposal. He had five wards, his own mess, and virtually anything else that he wanted. And what he did, word of his unique skill spread along the British battlefront, and he became known as the best known surgeon in the Allied armies. And he treated about 2,500 of these facial wounds that had been described. Let me give you an example of what he did. And here are the tents that they all lived under at that time. Go ahead on the next one. And what he would do, these are parts of the fractured jaws that are hanging down from a facial wound. He would make like wire appliances anchored to the teeth, and he would go down and he would bring these little fractured units up into alignment. And this did miracles for his treatment. And the next one, please. Now, here, I don't want to dwell on these facial, I'm not going to, but this is a story of a great loss of the lower lip, chin, and entire lower jaw is gone. And here is a soldier. So he makes for him a prosthesis that fills in all these missing parts. And then later on, he sutures the facial tissues over, and eventually this is the way the soldier looks. And the next one, please. And just to give you, these are plastic molds. This is what the original deformity was while he's treating it, and eventually in this way. Okay. But that's fine. Now he did these techniques, not really perfect. Thank you. was a last minute thing to be done. Now, the foundation of relayed for these battlefields of France, and this immigrant American was its architect. He set the standard and formulated the worsened and became grave, and at the age not even of 34 years old, she died. And that child is still alive. It was the gravest thing that could have happened to him. But nonetheless, he had this passion to go on. So he's 40 years of age. He does not have the medical degree, so he matriculates at Harvard Medical School. Now, the other students really didn't know much about him. He's lost his wife, he's working, he's teaching all at one time, and it's a difficult situation for him. And he's sitting up in the amphitheater with his other medical students, and two very famous British surgeons come to lecture to this class. And they're talking, and they're all of a sudden lecturing. All of a sudden, one of the surgeons grabs the arm of the other one, pointing up, and they rush up to the amphitheater steps. They drag Kazanjian down, and they say, "What are you doing up there? You're the one that taught us this technique that we're lecturing about." From then on, he became the hero of his class. And in 1921, he received a medical degree. Now, this allowed him to do in Boston the procedures that he had been doing all along in the fields of France. And began a practice plastic surgery, and it concentrated on surgery of the face, these prosthetic appliances, and patients from all over the world came to see him. He always said it was a privilege to treat. He never thought it was a chore. It was always a privilege to do it. Now, about in 1923, he remarried. He married Marianne Hanford, who was born in London. She was secretary to the dean of Harvard Medical School. You know, ever since I became interested in this, people would come up to me and they say, "You know, I'm going to tell you something about him that you should know." The Armenian women would always want him to marry an Armenian. And he would say something like, "Well, once I start on one road, I keep going in that same direction." So he kept marrying English, Swiss lady. So that, but that was the background. But he was on the staff of most all of the great hospitals in Boston. He was chief at the Massachusetts General Hospital, which is one of the great hospitals, and the Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary, and all of those big hospitals. So it was very well known. By the way, it's not very well known that he treated Sigmund Freud. Mm-hmm. Now, that's a story all its own. And may I have the next one, please? Now, Sigmund Freud loved to smoke cigars. It's said sometimes he smoked 20 of them in a day. And he developed a cancer of his mouth. And he lost a part of his jaw, and he had to wear a prosthesis. And there are stories of him having to put his thumb in his mouth to hold this, he called it the monster in his mouth. Well, it didn't work very well, so he wanted Kazanjian to go over there and treat him, which he knew that Kazanjian did. Freud described him as a little, the Armenian dentist with a smile like Charlie Chaplin. Really, I didn't think that was the right way to describe him, but nonetheless, that's the way it was. But he did make for him a prosthesis. He stayed in Vienna for 20 days and made for something for him. Now, Freud wore it for a number of years with great success. And I found this prosthesis in London at the Freud Museum. Now, Kazanjian was an outsider. He was by no means a person who was preoccupied with power. He was all substance and no image. Puffery was not part of his world. And hospital people who were near really didn't know what he had done. He was considered by many, and I'm referring to this Dr. Joseph Murray, who was a Nobel laureate in medicine, to be just a dentist. And he was not particularly welcome at some of these other hospitals. But nonetheless, humility with dignity really characterized him. These were his most notable traits. He was quiet and unassuming and almost apologetic. He was never known to negate a person's work. Even though he had an excellent command of English, his speech was always marked by an Armenian accent. And it was very difficult for him to explain what he was doing with the surgical techniques. Well, he never wore his Armenianism on his sleeve. He neither denied his Armenian background, he never anglicized his name. Why should I change my name? He said, does that change me? Does that change myself? Of course not. And he kept saying, self-pity is little less than mental suicide. He became involved in some Armenian activities, but not to a great extent. Yet, the New York World's Fair in 1939 singled him out as an outstanding representative of Armenian life in America. But nonetheless, generations of Armenian physicians and dentists could point with pride to someone who rose above their humble beginnings at that time. He operated without any wasted minutes, very decisive and fast. He was ambidextrous, but he didn't particularly like facelifts, didn't want to do those. And he operated almost every day of the week, but he was all doctor and all medicine, and they would call him K or Katsy. Now, one journalist would call him the father of modern plastic surgery, and may I have the next one, please? And here is one newspaper would call him the general genius of plastic surgery. And may I have the next one, please? And the world's most famous plastic surgeon, which is really how he is to be remembered even today. He continued working until he was 86, when his vision began to fail. He was the outstanding surgical figure in all of New England. But he never had a plastic surgery residency, and feeling that the climate in Boston was not satisfactory for that. and in 1949, and the next one is, I see, he wrote this very, very classic book called The Surgical Treatment of Facial Injuries with Varaztad Kazanjian and John Converse, who was his protege. And this became a very classic textbook. And he had many honors, Doctor of Science degree, visiting professorships have been named for him at New York University, and they have the next one. And here he is at New York University with Converse, and here is an operating room named for him in New York University. Okay, and he was made an honorary fellow of the American Association of Plastic Surgeons, and the next one, please. And here is that great plaque that gives him this honor. Now, while I was writing this book, out of the blue, I get an email from a person in Australia and concerning her grandfather, Ernest Carroll, who was who had developed horrible facial wounds and was treated by Kazanjian. And this is like almost 100 years later. And this lady writes to me that she was amazed at the quality of the surgery that was done on her grandfather. She was not aware of any facial deformity. And she said, if it had not been for Kazanjian, I would not have existed. And here, may I have that next one, please? And here is that soldier that I received from Australia. And here is the before, and here is the after, and there is the after. And this is the type of things that he would do. He would make these prosthesis appliances that he would wire the fragments and put everything in its assignment that way. Okay, well, Varaztad Kazanjian died in October 19th, 1974, in his 95th year. A very simple, dignified service was held at Harvard University, and I attended. He had been recognized by kings, by cardinals, great universities, political leaders, press of the world. And he would say, I'm just a technician, and remained happy and unruffled. It does please me when my colleagues think that I have done well. He had risen from obscurity to success without losing his humility and his humanity. An exhibit in his honor was held at Harvard, and the next one, please. And he met me once at a meeting, and this is Varaztad Kazanjian, and this is me. And he insisted that a photographer take our picture, and he assigned it to my good friend, Dr. Deranian, V.H. Kazanjian. Now, you can imagine how strong I feel about that particular thing. Now, at this memorial service that I attended, as I'm concluding my remarks, my thoughts returned to the times that I had first known him. Now remember, I grew up in Worcester, and he had lived there, and I even know the house that he lived in, which I have identified. And people would tell me with great pride, my father worked next to Kazanjian in the Warrangle, or we lived at 130 Belmont Street where he lived. And it would be a matter of great pride to these people. And here's one among them who rose to great heights. And as I got to know him, and I practiced in Boston, he would allow me to actually observe his operations, and I got to know him on more than a peripheral basis. And it's at that time that he had this picture taken of the two of us. And the next one, please. And here was a great exhibit held in Boston in 2001. This is Murray and Cannon and Kazanjian. These are the three pioneers of plastic surgery. Well, after he died, his widow wrote to me and told me that he had always felt very close to me, which I was very happy, and spoke of me often, which pleased me very much. And I knew that he had wanted me to write this book, and I have the next one too. And here is the book that I have written. That's called The Miracle Man of the Western Front, because we're talking about that part of France where the most horrible things were. And it's something that I just could not avoid doing. I had that same feeling when I wrote the book about the Armenians in Worcester, and as you will hear later, about this town of Husenay, where some of us in the room came from. I just had to tell these stories and preserve them. Well now, if there were one time or one place it could be singled out when the future direction of Dr. Karan Kazanjian's life was determined, it would be in 1900 in Worcester, Massachusetts, when he renounced the idea of returning to Hayastan, and someone said, "You take dentistry, that's a good subject." Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deranian. We really appreciate you coming and giving the talk today. We have a very special guest and a presentation by Councilman Paul Kerkorian from the City of Los Angeles at this time. We'll have questions after that.
Thank you, Martin. It's a great honor for me to be able to be here today to hear Dr. Deranian's lecture and to be here with all of you as the first Armenian ever elected to office in the 220-year history of the city of Los Angeles. It's a special pride for me to be able to come here and to hear this extraordinary story about one of the shining lights of the early Armenian American community. Wasn't this just an extraordinary story? And as any Armenian American, I would be proud to be able to come here and recognize the work of Dr. Deranian, because in a post-genocide era, often the people who have been victimized by genocide are further victimized going forward by the loss of their identity, and very often, because of the genocide that our people endured, our people are not able to have the connection with our own past that we should have. And Dr. Deranian, through his own efforts, through his own scholarship, through the use of his time to unearth stories like this and all the others that he talked about in his book, Worcester is America, and other works, he gives us the connection to our past that we otherwise would have lost. And I know this very personally, because when I was growing up as a young Armenian American here in Los Angeles, my most treasured possession was our old family Bible that had been brought over by my family from Harbert when they arrived here in the 1890s. And of course, not being able to read Armenian, I had no idea what the handwritten inscriptions in there said about my family. Fortunately, years later, I married my beautiful wife, Tamar, who's sitting in the front row, and she went through that painstakingly translating that Bible, and I learned that my family had settled in Worcester. And she sounded out phonetically that the village that we had come from was a place called Husenay. And so my wife then endeavored to research this, and she found that NAASR, in fact, had published a book called Husenay that was written by Dr. Deranian's father and translated by Dr. Deranian. So when Tamar and I were on a family vacation, we decided to stop in Worcester. We randomly selected a hotel to stay in. And as we pulled up to the hotel, we saw a beautiful old building adjacent to the hotel, beautiful old architecture, and it had a familiar look to it. And as I approached the entrance to this beautiful building, above the doorway, it said Washburn and Moen wire factory, the very wire factory that Dr. Deranian had just talked about, where my great-grandfather worked. And so it was chilling to me to have that experience. We found the only Armenian restaurant that seems to be left in Worcester. We had dinner there, met the owner. The owner happened to know Dr. Deranian and said, "You have to meet him. Let me get him on the phone." And Dr. Deranian was incredibly generous in coming out to Worcester to meet with us, to show us where my family had gone to church, where they had grown up, where they had their social engagements. And all of this would have been lost, as would have the connection that I had with my own ancestors, who were written about in this book and in his book, Worcester is America, that would have been lost to the ravages of time forever. Their memory would have been lost, their stories would have been lost, and future generations of Krikorians never would have known about our own family history and our community's history and our people's history, but for the work, the incredible work of Dr. Martin Deranian. So on a very personal level, and on behalf of the Armenian community, I want to thank you for this incredible work that you've done, Dr. Deranian. And on behalf of the city of Los Angeles, which, by the way, is the home of the largest population of Armenians anywhere in the world outside of Yerevan, it gives me great pleasure to be able to present to you this certificate of recognition from the city of Los Angeles, presented to Dr. Martin Deranian. And it reads, "Miracle Man of the Western Front is a tremendous contribution to the growing collection of work on Armenian Americans and their collective history by illustrating Dr. Varaztad Kazanjian's remarkable story of perseverance and success. You have helped inspire us all. Best of luck as you continue your much appreciated efforts to document the intriguing history of the Armenians in the United States." Dr.
And now there's time for questions. If anyone would like to ask questions, now's the time. Thank you very much.
I'd like to express my appreciation to this museum. When I walk into here, I am just transported, very moved. And I thank you all for coming. And above all, for Paul for doing this. This beyond any expectation that I had. By the way, did you know that his family ran a circus? They were the Krikor circus, and they were all over, and particularly in St. Louis, and there was a fire, and this is all reported in my book, and it was destroyed. But nonetheless, they come through as a very enterprising family. Imagine coming to America and of all things, having a circus. I mean, doesn't that blow your mind? Yeah. Do that.
Okay, and now so I'm in the LA City Council, so I'm still running.
Any questions?
I am here. If there are any questions anybody wishes to pose to me, and I'm available for this or anything otherwise, I'll be happy to. Yes, did you have something to?
First, thank you, Dr. Deranian, for such an inspiring, interesting talk. I wanted to ask you, was Dr. Kazanjian at all acquainted with Dr. Kerklikian of Chicago, the plastic surgeon who helped Senator Dole?
Yes. You know, the people are often confusing when they seem to decide who was with them. I'm sure they knew each other, but they were in different specialties. Kazanjian was a plastic surgeon. He was an orthopedic surgeon, so there was a difference. Both of them served with great distinction
and contributed to this, their specialty, but I did not think that they were otherwise related.
I thought perhaps he inspired Dr.
Well, thank you. Yes, you have another question?
So I'm gonna give you two examples so you understand where I'm coming from. I hope it orients you a little bit better. Hovhannes Ivanovsky was a very famous painter. But what people don't know or realize about him is that in 1896, I feel like because they're similar in time about us, that when the 1896 massacres happened, anybody who was able to escape out of Western Armenia, Turkey, and made it to Feodosia, Ivanovsky made it a point to take care of them, food, shelter, work. He made all means necessary so any Armenian who made it to Feodosia on the other side of the Black Sea was well cared for by another Armenian. So I have a point to make, so I have a question to ask you.
Sure.
Rafi, which is a very famous writer, writes about a guy named Provesios, Barul Haygaz, who actually leaves Armenia, goes all the way to Rome, becomes a very great orator. Caesar was so impressed by him that makes a statue for him. And Rafi, in his volumes of work, says, I understand, Barul Haygaz, you went to Rome, you became a great, incredible man. Everybody loved you. You were a god. Caesar even made a statue for you. But you never once turned around and looked at your homeland of Armenia. Who needs an Armenian like you? So my humble question, right, is that you mentioned the little boy who was bursting with Armenianism and then 21 years old decides not to go back. But then I'm kind of curious. The rest of his life he spent slaving in America and slaving for the British. What did the Armenian nation understand from him?
Okay, I'm well aware of this dilemma that you're posing. I've thought about it a lot. I suppose he paid a price for his greatness. And if it meant sort of separating himself from his Armenianism, I think that's the price he paid. And I'm sure that he did pay a price for that. But wait a minute. Don't you think we all benefit from what he did? Don't you think all of us stand a little bit taller because a man like this rose from obscurity to contribute to the world, to make the world better? Don't you think each of us feel a little more dignity in our own around beings for what one of our own people did? Of course we do.
For whom?
For us, for me and you, for you.
He did it for us.
Of course.
He did it for us.
How can that be denied? We one of our own rose to this great height. I think we all benefit from that effort to do that. But I'm aware of what you're saying, and I've thought about that a lot. Yes.
But he didn't change his last name.
He did not. It was always Varaztad Hovhannes Kazanjian. And he wrote and he said, reporters had said to him, how come you didn't change your name? And he said, it would not change me. It would not. Does it change me if I change my name? So he did not change the name ever. No, he did not. That I have to say.
Now, one more question?
Yes, John.
Do we know anything about his family that he left behind?
Are there any members?
At age 15 or 16, he said he left Armenia. Do you have any siblings or what?
Yes, he did. He had. Of his first wife, who died at childbirth, Helene, that daughter is still alive. He had two children of his second wife, Hanford, but they're both dead. He has a grandson who is an Episcopal priest. He has another grandson who is a teacher of English. As far as I know, they did not... they're still somewhat involved, but they're not involved deeply in the Armenian community, as far as I can tell. Yes, Paul.
Dr. Deranian, are you familiar with any Armenian that would have graduated from Harvard earlier than that? That has to have been
no, there were. There were, as far as I know. He had actually a classmate who was also an Armenian, so I knew about that in that same class. I knew about that. I'm sure there were others, but I cannot at this point in time elucidate. But I'm sure there were. So, yes.
Are any of his works reported in the journals of medicine or any books written about his techniques and things that are being perhaps followed or controlled this day in the facial-muscular surgeries?
There are many articles about him in the journals, but my book is the definitive one that records all of this material. There is in the Conway Library of Medicine at Harvard, there is a section where his books are displayed and where some of these artifacts are kept. For example, these molds that I showed you, they're preserved in one section of the Harvard Conway Library of Medicine. That I'd have to say. But as far as definitive books, I must say that the one I've written is the one. There are articles, many articles, but this is the one book, I would say. Yes?
One last question.
How is the wonderful Arlene Francis related to you?
Okay, Arlene and Francis was a Kazanjian. Her father was related to Varaztad Kazanjian, but they were not first cousins, as has always been implied. But they were related, but let's say third cousins or something like that. Yeah, and definitely.
Sure.
All
right.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here today. There's refreshments in the other room. Please come around and talk to Dr. Deranian, Councilman, and if you'd like to donate to the museum.
It's nice to see you again. Thank you so much.
Thank you all for being
here.
Thank you all for being here.
I think it's just something that I would have.